These are some preliminary results I got during my PhD under the University of Montreal. So, well, traditionally, pollinators have been seen as the driver of atmospheric pollution, and it's widely accepted that some features of the angiosperms, such as the roller shape, adapts to pollinators in order to transfer, to optimize pollen transfer. However, the exact role of pollinators is not always understood in this context, mainly due to two reasons. First, different pollinators exert selective pressures that may vary in intensity. And second, even if we tend to think of plant-pollinator relationships as one-to-one, on the field what we've seen is that they tend to be really, really generalized. So this obscures the relative role of each pollinator. So one way to gain more insight into this subject is by taking a look at convergence. So sometimes we see the same phenotype arising multiple times throughout the phylogeny of a given imaginary group like this one. And if we look closely at the base of this convergence, we might find a transition towards a common pollinator. So this gives us the opportunity to see how different phenotypes, well, how the same phenotype arise on each of these independent times. So, so in this context, I study the genus Eucharina, which belongs to the lichen family, and is formed by 132 species from tropical distribution. Most of them are trees, like this beautiful specimen here. So the red thing are actually the flowers. It sheds the flowers before it sheds the leaves. And the particular characteristic that makes it really interesting is that it has many flower morphologies, and they're in principle associated to different pollinators. So traditionally, two flower morphologies have been considered. So on the left side, you see one that is more tubular. Inflorescences tend to be vertical. Well, they're vertical in all cases, I think. And nectar tends to be concentrated in this group. And it has traditionally been associated to hummingbird pollination. And we have another group that is more, with species that are more open flowered, and inferences tend to be horizontal, and the nectar tends to be more diluted as well. And it has been associated to passerine pollination. However, recent studies show that these morphologies are not the only ones. So we see another one that is also quite tubular on the left side, and which is actually quite similar to that of hummingbird pollination, at least superficially. And it's actually associated to a kind of passerine sunbirds, which behave in a similar way to hummingbirds in some aspects. And then we have yet another morphology that would be associated to a generalized pollination mode, including hummingbirds, passerines, and bees as well. When we look at flowers of these genus, most of the times we're only seeing the standard petal, and the other petals tend to be hidden at the base in the calyx. I put this example so it shows all the petals, but sometimes they're just hidden at the base. And that's one of the reasons why the standard is believed to play a primary role in mediating plant pollinator infections in this group. So previous studies have used molecular phylogenies using both nuclear and chloroplast genes and pollination mode as seen on the field or as inferred from nectar traits to reveal that hummingbird pollination here in red has arisen multiple independent times from an ancestral passerine pollination mode here depicted in blue. And we'll see that mixed pollination in yellow and sunbird pollination in light blue are also in the right conditions. However, how this relates to the appearance of a common of different floral morphologies is what we want to know. So to do this, we have used samples of flowers, both obtained in the field or that were kindly donated from different herbaria. So we dissected and mounted this sample flowers. So we had a total of 500 flowers and belonging to 91 species. So the end result of mounting was something like this. And if we take a closer look at one of these specimens, you can see that the standard petal is either folded or cut longitudinally in two symmetric halves. And then we have the wings and the field petals. So then to understand different shapes and to compare them, we have used a geometric morphometric approach. So geometric morphometrics allows us to record and compare shapes in a quite objective way. And so we use three landmarks and 4D semi-landmarks. So landmarks belong to fixed points at the base and at the tip of the petal. In this case, it would be a standard petal. And then we have 4D semi-landmarks, which would be represented by the dots, which are equally spaced along the outline. And then we've run across this PCA analysis. So it's basically a principal component analysis that uses petal shape in this case, instead of other quantitative variables. And so these are the results for the standard petals. So first, so this is a morpho space, and in our morpho space, we see that the species that are more to the right, they tend to be more tubular, more longer. And then the species are more that have petals, standard petals, more wider, tend to be more to the left-hand side. And as well, species that are on the that have a more spoon-like shape tend to be on the upper part of the graph, and others that have a more convex shape tend to be on the lower part of the graph. And what it's what the most obvious feature of this result is that all the hummingbird-pollinated species, once again in red, tend to cluster on the right-hand side. But here we would only use the pollination mode as seen in the field. We didn't want to use any inference from nectar traits. Then we run a phylogenetic ANOVA to compare the shapes of the standard petals in hummingbird and fast-running pollinated species. And we got that there were highly significant differences, and the R-squared value, so the amount of the variance that would be explained by our factors, it was quite high. So 36% of our variance was explained by our pollinators. We didn't use the mixed and sandbird pollination because our N wasn't high enough. Then if we look at the field petals, we still see a pattern here. So the hummingbird pollinated species tend to be more on the lower right side of the graph of the morpho space, and the fast-ring pollinated species tend to be more on the upper left side of the graph. The pattern is less clear, but still the phylogenetic ANOVA was significant, and around 30% of the variance was explained by the pollinators in this case. But then, if we look at the keel petals, the pattern is not very clear, and actually our phylogenetic ANOVA didn't give any significant results. So, as I said previously, we didn't want to use pollination mode as inferred from nectar traits in order not to bias our analysis. So what we did instead is that we use continuous, well, the shape data and a method called surface to understand how different morphologies evolve. So this method was developed in 2015 and basically it only uses quantitative traits quantitative characters of our traits of interest, so it can take one more than one quantitative trait, and a phylogeny, and it, basically it's a method that works in two steps. So in the first step, it's going to detect all the phenotypes that differ significantly from the ancestral phenotype as detected by the model, and then in the second step, so it would be the graph, the tree more to the right, it's going to compare the different phenotypes, the right phenotypes among them, and it's going to see if they're convergent or not. So we use the first two principal components for our different petals and the phylogeny of the genus. And so these are the results we obtained. I'm going to go color by color, but first, so in black we'll have the ancestral pollination mode. In black, we'll have the ancestral pollination mode, and I've illustrated this with one of my specimens. So everything in black would look something similar to the sample of Eritrean excelsa that has been represented there. So then we have two phenotypes that are actually quite similar and that they have multiple origins. So this phenotype, so this one with three origins, and the next one, which is very similar to the previous one, they are both characterized by long standard petals, tubular flowers, and reduced scales and wings. So what is interesting is that the species in this group, as revealed by the data we've seen on the field, tend to be pollinated by hummingbirds in all cases except for one. So then we took take a look at all the remaining phenotypes that have been detected by the method surface. We see this one. It is actually quite similar to the ancestral phenotype, but with the only difference that, well, many small differences, but the most evident difference is that the keel petals are actually quite large. And in this clade, we find mostly mixed pollinated species. So that it's very interesting places. And then we have other phenotypes. I'm gonna go very fast through them. So it would be this one with large standard petals and open flowers. And this other one, so if there's only one species that is recognized to have this particular phenotype, that are actually quite similar, again, to the ancestral phenotype, but they have differences when we look at the keels and the wing petals. So so these are the different morphologies that you can compare them. There's quite a variety there. So moving on to my conclusions here, we have seen that first, floral shape is evolutionary labile. It might change a lot throughout the evolution of a relatively small group like this one. And here we have a good example of floral shape convergence in legumes under different pollination regimes. So we'll give ground to this hypothesis that actually flower shape evolution is driven by pollinators. And then one other thing we see is that hummingbirds seem to exert a really strong selective pressure on at least on some features of the corolla shape, such as the standard. As we can see on the morpho spaces, all the species with hummingbird pollination tend to have standards that are actually quite similar, and this seems to evolve multiple independent times. And next. More about the technique, the use of more objective data like that is given by geometric morphometrics, and then methods like surface, seems to be a more objective way of understanding convergence rather than relying on a priori categories that could be potentially biased, like the pollination mode. So I would like to thank the herbaria that have kindly donated samples for this study, so the New York herbarium and the Montreal herbarium. And also my funders, Mutua Madrileña, la Fundación Bancaria y la Caixa, and the Canadian Council for Research and Engineering. So thank you very much for listening. And if you have any questions, please feel free to ask me.
Using
different principal components, we get different results. But the more we add in this case, the better resolution we have. One of the disadvantages of the surface method is that you're not able to assign like weight to each of our characters. So adding them adds resolution normally, but it might also blur results.
So you can't get character
loadings.
You can't get character loadings?
No. Mostly in Africa and the Americas, but some of them come from publications done from with the Asiatic groups and stuff. Yeah. Yeah.
I forgot to check, but once you get hummingbird shade, are you stuck there? Once you get that hummingbird flower, are you stuck there?
Are
there any reversions?
Yes, there is at least one reversal, which is quite interesting because the shape. It's detected by the surface method to be exactly the same as hummingbird pollinated species, with the only difference that instead of being perfectly tubular, it opens up the ascender, so it's an open flower, but then the shape is similar. So yeah, there's some reversals. Yes. Not necessarily.
Involved in
that? Sorry? For most of the cases, no. For example, in Hawaii, there is Erythrina sanguinensis, and some of the populations of this species have reversed to white, but most of them are red. Actually.
Okay, we're
going to
stop here.
Thank you.